हाय फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर जी एन पुरोहित, द फॉर्मर हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ वेटनरी गायनेकोलॉजी एंड ऑब्स्टेट्रिक्स, कॉलेज ऑफ वेटनरी एंड एनिमल साइंसेज बीकानेर, राजस्थान यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ वेटनरी एंड एनिमल साइंसेज बीकानेर, एंड द फॉर्मर डीन पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट स्टडीज, राजस्थान यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ वेटनरी एंड एनिमल साइंसेज बीकानेर. सो फ्रेंड्स, इन आवर टूडेज टॉक I'll be explaining you something about the reproductive anatomy of the female, and in this my second lecture I'll be talking about the tubular structures and the external genitals of the female domestic animals. So let us start. So friends, we start discussing in our today's talk about the reproductive organs, and if you have not already subscribed to my channel, kindly do subscribe to it so that you receive our videos very fast. And we discuss about the tubular genitalia. We have already discussed about the generative organs in our previous lecture. So the tubular genitalia, they include the fallopian tube. They are tube like and hollow inside, and then the uterine horns, the body of the uterus, the cervix, and then the vagina coming to up to the external genital organs. The now we talk about the embryonic origin. The as we have talked in our previous class, that the gonadal ridge or the genital ridge and the mesonephros, they arise from the urogenital ridge, and from the urogenital ridge there appears two mounds. And from these mounds, from the genital ridge, develop the ovaries, and parts of the mesonephros and genital ridge also forms the two ducts, the Wolffian duct and the Mullerian duct. The Mullerian duct, also known as the paramesonephric ducts, and in the female, since there is absence of the anti-Mullerian hormone, so the Mullerian duct result into differentiation, forming the upper third of the vagina, the cervix, both fallopian tubes and the uterus. The Wolffian ducts in the female, since there is absence of the SRY gene, the Y chromosome, so the mesonephric ducts, they result, they regress in the female, but parts of it and the urogenital sinus forms the lower vagina, labia and the clitoris. Then we talk about the attachments of the uterus. The uterus is held in place by a fold of peritoneum, what is broadly known as the broad ligament. And the broad ligament, it holds the uterus, which is, that part is known as the mesometrium, and the part that holds the oviduct is known as the mesosalpinx, whereas the part that holds the ovary is known as the mesovarium. Then there is the pelvic diaphragm, which also holds the uterus in place. The pelvic diaphragm is formed by the coccygeal and levator ani muscles and their fascia attached to the coccygeal vertebra and the pelvis. Then the muscles of the vagina, vestibule and the vaginal muscles also form the pelvic diaphragm. Then there are two peritoneal pouches. One is the rectogenital pouch and the second one is vesicogenital pouch. The rectogenital pouch is formed by the peritoneum of the rectum over the vagina, and the vesicogenital pouch is formed by peritoneum of the bladder on the vagina. So now in this picture, you can very well see the broad ligament. It is attached to the sides walls of the pelvic cavity and the abdominal cavity. This broad ligament is holding the parts of the uterus, and then this is the uterine horn, and then this is the interconval ligament, and then on another side also this is the broad ligament which is attaching to the body of the pelvic cavity or the abdominal cavity wall. And then here you can see this is the rectum, and this rectum is opposing over the uterus, and this forms a pouch of peritoneum, what is known as the rectogenital pouch. Then the uterus has the uterine horns are attached by two interconval ligament, the dorsal interconval ligament, this one, and the ventral interconval ligament. These interconval ligaments hold the uterus. In this picture also you can see the interconval ligament, the holding the dorsal and the ventral interconval ligament over here. This is one uterine horn, and then this is another uterine horn, and these are held by the interconval ligament. There are no interconval ligaments in the bitch and the sow, because the uterine horns are straight and located in the abdominal cavity, so there are no interconval ligaments in these two species. Now in the sow, the broad ligament attaches near the point of the spine. You can see here the broad ligament is attaching near the point of the spine and running continuously with the innermost layer of the abdominal cavity. This is the abdominal cavity. So it is running continuously with the layer of the abdominal cavity. And in this picture you can very well see that the broad ligament, the mesometrium and the mesovarium. Then in the bitch, the uterine horns are located in the bitch and sow. The uterine horns are located in the abdominal cavity, and they rest on the coils of jejunum, and there are the round ligaments additionally. Then we talk of the oviduct. The oviduct is the structure which connects the uterus. This is the uterus, and it connects the uterus with the fimbria, which catches hold of any of the oocyte that is being released by the ovary. Say ovary releases a oocyte here, it goes to the fimbria, and then it travels the fallopian tube and enters into the uterus. So the fallopian tube, it has got three parts: the isthmus, this is the isthmus, and then the ampulla, which is a broader part, and the broadest part is the fimbria, which catches hold of the oocyte, and then there is the infundibulum. The fimbria, it moves around before ovulation in cattle and most ruminant species, and then gathers the oocyte release from the ovary. Then in this picture you can see this is the oviduct of the mare, and these are the two uterine horns lying on the floor. Then in these pictures also you can very well see this is the uterine horn, and then this is the uterotubal junction where the uterine horn attaches with the oviduct. Then this is the isthmus, and this is the ampulla. This is the ampulla, and this is the ovary, and this is the ovarian bursa. So then there will be the fimbria of the, and then in this picture also you can see the infundibulum, the ampulla, and the ostium. Now we talk about the histological structures of the oviduct, or the layers of the oviduct. The oviduct, it has got many layers. The mucosal membrane, which is a complex, which has complex fold with branches. It is highly branched in the ampulla. Then there is the surface epithelium. It is ciliated, and it is highest ciliated in the fimbria and lowest in the isthmus. Then oviduct has surface epithelium has got the non-ciliated Peck cells. These Peck cells have the secretory function. Then there is the muscularis, or the inner circular layer and outer less developed muscularis layer. Then there is the serosa, the simple squamous epithelium. In this picture you can see this is the lumen of the oviduct, and this is the tunica serosa, this is the lamina propria or tunica submucosa, and then this is the muscle layer, and this is the outermost, the serosal layer. So this is how, these are the parts of the oviduct. Then we have talked in our previous slide that the branching is much more marked in the ampullary region. You can see here the branching is much more marked. And then the isthmus part is having a lower, smaller lumen, whereas the oviductal part, or the ampulla and the infundibulum, the diameter is broader. Then this is the ampullary isthmic junction, and here from the ovary, say it releases a oocyte, which is shown over here. It falls in the fimbria, and then it travels through the oviduct to reach the uterus. In most domestic animal species, the fertilized or unfertilized ova, it enters the uterus, but it is a special mechanism in the mare in which unfertilized ova never enter into the uterus. And it is something which is a papillae located here. It has been said that it is papillae is located here that relaxes when the embryo is fertilized, and it releases estrogen. This relaxes the or it releases prostaglandins, and then the fertilized embryo, it enters the uterus. The oviductal mucosa is made up of primary, secondary and tertiary folds. As we have talked, the folds are much more marked in the ampullary region. Then the mucosa of the oviduct, it consists of the one layer of columnar epithelial cells, which are either ciliated, or we have talked they are non-ciliated. The ciliated cells of the oviduct have slender cilia, which are known as the kinocilia, and the movement of the kinocilia beat towards the uterus in one portion, and they beat to propel, they beat towards the oviduct in another end. So it propels the oocyte from one from the infundibulum part towards the ampulla and then the uterotubal junction, whereas on the other hand it propels the spermatozoa from the uterus towards the oviduct where fertilization takes place. And then in this picture you can see the histological picture, and this one is a picture showing the infundibulum and the ovary of a mare, and this is the ampulla, and this is the isthmus, and attaching to the uterus, the uterine horn. Now, the uterine end of the oviduct in the dog and mare, it opens into the uterine lumen through a small slit on a mound or papilla. you can see a mound or the papilla. This is a endoscopic view of a Meyer oviduct showing the papilla. Then we talk of the most important organ, the uterus. The uterus is a hollow tubular structure and it is considered the organ of the pregnancy because it is this organ which carries the pregnancy towards the entire gestation. The uterus has got three parts, the neck, or you can see here the cervix. This is the cervix, then the body or the corpus and the cornua. These are two uterine horns which are known as the cornua. So this is a uterus of a cow, this one is of a goat, and this is a buffalo uterus. Now the uterus is an organ which carries the pregnancy, and it is the organ where from the spermatozoa travel towards the oviduct, and the fertilized embryos are transported to the uterus, where it attaches in the uterine wall, and then the pregnancy continues for the gestation period, which is specific for the species. Now we talk of the location of the uterine horn. In most ruminant species, the uterine horns are located in the pelvic cavity. In some crossbred Holstein Friesian cows, the uterine horns will be located just ahead of the pelvic brim. This is the pelvic brim, and just ahead of it, the uterine horns will be located in cattle, in sheep, in buffaloes, in goats. You can see here how they are located. The this is the rectum, and just beneath the rectum, the uterine horns are located, and these are the broad ligaments attaching the uterus. These are the broad ligaments attaching the uterus to the body wall, and then these are the wings of the ilium. So this is how the uterine horns are located. But in the mare, the uterine horns may be located on the pelvic floor, but sometimes they are hanging just ahead of the pelvic brim. As we talked in an earlier lecture, the ovaries are located just near the iliac crest and just behind the kidneys. These are the kidneys. So then for transrectal palpation, the Meyer uterus is very difficult to be identified because the Meyer does not have very tonicity except during early gestation. The Meyer will show tone in the uterus. Then the location of the uterine horns in the bitch and sow is completely abdominal, and you can see here the uterine horns are abdominally located in the sow, and they are equally abdominally located in the bitch. They are long tubular structures located in the abdominal cavity in these two species and also the cat. Then the shape of the uterus. The shape of the uterus is depends on the species, and in the mare they are T-shape. You can see here this is a T-shape, and then the two uterine horns lie parallel to each other in cattle. In the sow, the uterine horns have an intestinal loop like appearance and located in the abdomen. Again, in the bitch, the uterine horns are long and located on in the abdominal cavity. And you can see here the sow and the bitch uterine horns do not have a intercornual ligament. Then there has been a lot of discrepancy in the description of the types of uterus, and it has been mentioned that they are either bicornuate or bipartite or simplex or duplex. more recent evidence, it suggests that the uterus type is either duplex, in which there is a clear cut uterus separately and they have two cervix and the uterine horns are completely separate, and this is present in rodents and lagomorphs. For for most of the domestic animal species, the uterus has been now labeled as bicornuate long, which is seen in carnivores and the sows, and they are bicornuate short as seen in the ruminants and the equid species. The uterus is simplex in primates, and then these are some of the pictures of the actual uterine horns. These are of cattle. This one is of cattle, cow. You can see here, this is the bladder, and this is again a drawing of a cattle uterus. And very interestingly, the uterine horns of a female camel. The female camel, it has got uterine horns which are either T shape or they are sometimes Y shape. Now, one of the uterine horn, the right uterine horn, is smaller because there is exceptional left uterine horn pregnancy only in the female camel. Now, this exceptionally, the pregnancy occurs only and only and only in the left uterine horn. This is very specific for camel, and the pregnancy, maybe ovulation has occurred either in the right ovary or in the left ovary, but it will, the embryo will migrate and it will always establish in the left uterine horn. Now, that is why the right uterine horn is smaller as compared to the left uterine horn in the female camel. Then this is the, these are the genitalia of, actual genitalia of a sow. You can see here, they have intestinal loop-like appearance. They just appear just like intestinal loops, and the actual genitalia record from the canine, and they are located in the abdomen. Then the uterine horns of a mare, the uterine horns of a mare are T-shaped, and you can see here the location. This is a model to show the location of the uterine horns in the mare. This is the rectum, and just underneath the rectum, you can see this is the vaginal part, this is the anus, and the vagina and the uterine horn, T-shape, just located. And the ovaries are palpable. You can see this is the iliac crest, and underneath the iliac crest, you can palpate the ovary. So if you put your hand inside the rectum, you will not find the ovaries here. You will have to take your hand to one side, slightly upwards, so that you can locate, one can locate the ovaries and palpate them. The uterine horn appearance in different animal species, we have talked about it earlier also. They are straight and divergent in the mare. They are round, parallel to each other in cattle, buffalo, ruminant species, most ruminant species, and then in the sow they have a intestinal loop appearance. In the bitch they are straight and divergent, and in the female camel they are T or Y shape. Then the uterine layers, or the tissue layers of the uterus. The tissue layers of the uterus include the tunica serosa, the perimetrium, which is the outermost layer, and then there is connective tissue, and then there is the tunica muscularis, what we call the myometrium. The myometrium has both the inner circular, which is one layer, and the longitudinal outer layer, which has two layers. Muscles are present in the uterus, and the innermost is the tunica mucosa or the endometrium. The endometrium or is the innermost layer of the uterus, and the endometrium, when we just open the, in this picture, you can see the outermost is perimetrium. This is perimetrium, this one outermost, and then the myometrium. This is the myometrium, and then this is the endometrium. The endometrium has got the carunculus, small round structures raised inside when you cut it, and this is a cross section showing the different layers of the uterus, the endometrium, the myometrium, and the perimetrium. Again, in a cross section, you can see here the layers of the uterus, the serosal layer, the outermost, and then there is the perimetrium, this one, and then these are the longitudinal muscles, and then these are the circular muscles. These are the circular muscles, and these are the longitudinal muscles. Then this is the endometrium, and this is the lumen of the uterus, which is hollow inside, and this is the submucosa, and this is the mucosa. The uterine endometrium, it consists of submucosa and the endometrial glands. The endometrial glands, the endometrium is highly glandular over the entire lining except in the ruminants. As we talked earlier, the ruminants have mushroom shaped projections called the caruncles, where fetal membranes attach, and the fetal sides are called the cotyledons. The caruncles on the maternal side and the cotyledons on the fetal side. In the sow and mare, the uterine folds are present. Now the uterine endometrium appears to be very important because it is the place which helps in nourishing the early embryo. It is the part which by secretions from the endometrial glands which are present in the submucosa, and it also helps in implantation by secreting certain proteins which help in the implantation process. The embryonic proteins, a lot of embryonic proteins have been identified, half of which are of fetal origin and half of which are of maternal origin. And these maternal origin proteins, they are derived from the endometrial glands. And collectively, the secretions that the endometrium secrete is known as the histotrophs. These histotrophs help in the establishment of pregnancy. Also, the uterine endometrium, it secretes one of the hormone, the prostaglandin F2 alpha, which regulates the estrus cycle in most domestic animal species. Thus, the uterine endometrium is one of the important part. The muscles of the uterus, they help in propelling the sperms, and they also help in the delivery of the fetus at the time of parturition by their contractions. Then you can see here the cotyledons are convex in cattle, but they are concave in sheep, and the fetal membranes, they attach by the different cotyledons, and they are concave in the eve, having a depression, and then the mare placental formation, it has got many microcotyledons through which the placenta attaches. Now we talk of another important part, the neck of the uterus or the cervix. The cervix is a sphincter that connects the uterus and vagina, and cervix is a fibrous organ composed predominantly of the connective tissue with only small amount of muscle tissue. So cervix is the portion which basically prevents the entry of this is the cervix. This cervix, it prevents the entry of microbes in the uterus, and it attaches to the vagina, the outer tubular layer, and then when it attaches, there is a hollow space which is known as the fornix. This is the fornix. Then this is the external os, or the os externus. The os externus is the place where one has to pass the catheter for passing some drugs into the uterus, or for artificial insemination also. Now in this picture you can very well see that the cervix has two openings. One is towards the vagina, that is known as the external cervical os, this one, and then there is the internal os. And when one performs the artificial insemination, he has to cross the catheter through both these openings to reach the uterus. Then this is the uterine body, and this is the fornix, the place, a blind space where the cervix attaches to the vagina is known as the fornix. Then the cervical canal, it has got many prominences, the mucosal folds, and the in ruminants, these are present in the form of transverse or spirally arranged parts, the known as the annular rings. You can see here, this is the annular ring, another annular ring, another annular ring, and they are prominent in the cow, usually 3 to 4 rings in cattle, 1 to 2 in buffalo, 4 to 5 in goats, and 6 to 7 rings in the sheep, in which they fit into each other to close the cervix securely. And the cervix in the buffaloes is comparatively shorter and narrower. Then there are glands in the cervix, the Nabothian glands line the cervix, and these glands, they release the mucus at the time of estrus. Now we talk of the layers or the composition of the cervix. Cervix is made up of the ground substance, it is made up of fibrous constituents, and it is made up of cellular contents. The ground substance include the proteoglycan, hyaluronic acid, dermatan sulfate, and proteins. The fibrous constituents, which are very important, are include the collagen and the elastin and reticulin. These three play a role in relaxation of the cervix at the time of parturition by breakdown of the collagen bonds, and relaxing the cervix for easy propulsion of the fetus out. Then the cellular content include the fibroblasts, the mast cells, and the wandering cells. So these are the constituents of the cervix. Then the bovine cervix, it has got the cervical crypts, and it has been mentioned that these crypts, they help in the storage of the spermatozoa during natural mating, or maybe during artificial insemination, and time and again the sperms are released from these cervical crypts towards the uterus. Then it has got simple columnar epithelium, and some of the cells are ciliated. The fornix, where a fold of skin which forms where the cervix attaches with the vagina, is absent in the sow. Then the cervix, as you can see, in cattle there are cervical annular rings, and in the mare there are no cervical annular rings, whereas in the sow the cervix has got a corkscrew type interdigitating arrangement that adapts to the spiral twisting of the tip of the boar's penis. So these are the structures of the cervix in different animal species. The male cervix is very soft, it is very friable, one can dilate it with his finger, and it does not have fibrous tissue or the cervical annular rings. The male cervix is difficult to be located by transrectal palpation because of the soft nature, and it becomes difficult for a palpating veterinarian to make out the cervix. Now the sheep cervix, it has got 6 to 7 annular rings, and this renders, this makes the passage of the catheter inside the sheep cervix very difficult. You can see here in this picture, again a catheter cannot go like this because of the zigzag path that forms because of the 6 to 7 curved cervical annular rings in sheep. It becomes difficult to pass the catheter inside the cervix. Again, the sheep cervix, based on the outer appearance, has been given different names. The star, this is the star cervix, appears like a star. This is a duck bill, then the crescent, spiral, cluster, and the bump shape of cervix. Based on the external appearance in the vaginal canal, these and many of these types are visible in sheep. Again, you can see the different types of the cervix shapes in sheep, and so one has to be very careful, and it's not very easy to pass the catheter inside the cervix. Then we talk of the canine cervix. Now it is pertinent to understand here that canine cervix is very, very peculiar shape. It is perpendicular to the vagina, and you see it is going this way, and then this is the uterine horn. So it's not possible to pass any catheter, any drug, infused drug in the uterus of a female bitch because of the nature of the cervix that the bitch has. And then this is the external uterine ostium, internal uterine ostium, and the uterine body. This is the urinary bladder, and then this one is a picture, a hysteroscopic endoscopic picture showing the location of the cervix. So artificial insemination, or maybe passing that infusing any drug inside the canine uterus, is really, really not possible with ease. In this picture again, you can see the cervix. You can see one can pass the catheter up to this place, but the catheter cannot turn like this and enter into the uterus. So it's difficult to pass any catheter, any medicine, or even artificial insemination in the bitch using a catheter. There are some reports of using a Scandinavian catheter in the bitch for artificial insemination, but that needs a lot of practice, and one has to use it in the same type of breed of the bitch. Again, you can see here this picture showing the fornix, a blind end, and then a perpendicular nature of the cervix in comparison to the vagina in the sagittal section. Then there is a presence of canine pseudocervix. In the cranial sides of the vaginal cavity of the bitch, the diameter of the lumen is reduced to less than half of the caudal diameter. In addition, a longitudinal dorsal median fold, which is known as the pseudocervix, can be observed that ends at the site of the cervical tubercle. Now, these are two endoscopic views showing the cervical tubercle and the pseudocervix. It feels like a cervix, but it's not actually the cervix. It appears like a cervix, but it is not actually the cervix. Then the camel cervix. The camel cervix, it has got, it is soft just like the equine cervix. You can just pass your finger inside. But the thing is, it has got 3 to 4 longitudinal folds. These are the longitudinal folds. And the external cervical orifice is surrounded by 1 to 2 circular folds. These are the circular folds of the cranial part of the vagina. Then cervix projects caudally in the vaginal cavity, forming a small fornix. So fornix is present in the camel also. Now we talk of the vagina. Vagina is a musculomembranous collapsed tube that extends from the external cervical os to the vulvar cleft. This is the vulva, and it extends from the cervix to the vulvar cleft. Now the part where the external urethral orifice opens, this has been labeled as the anterior vagina or the vagina proper, and this is the posterior vagina, or it is also known as the vestibule. The vaginal wall consists of surface epithelium, muscular coat, and serosa. The muscular coat is less developed compared to the uterine musculature. The muscularis is well developed with blood vessels, nerve fibers. The cow is unique in possessing an anterior sphincter muscle in addition to the posterior sphincter muscle found in other farm animals. This one is a picture, is a endoscopic picture of the bovine vagina, taken for you to understand. Then the posterior vagina, or what is known as the vestibule. The vestibule starts from the external urethral orifice and thus forms the region common to urinary and reproductive urinary systems. On the ventral floor of vagina, beneath the mucosa and running the length of vagina, there are two ducts, what are known as the Gartner's ducts, which are the remnants of primitive mesonephric ducts, or the Wolfian ducts, are frequently present. It forms a blind pouch near the urethral opening, which is known as the suburethral diverticulum, which is seen in sow, ewe, cow, and buffalo, and this is considered to prevent the entry of the urine in the uterus. Then there are the vestibular glands. The vestibular glands are the Bartholin's gland, and they are located in the constrictor muscles of the vestibule. In cows, each of these glands open to lateral wall of the vestibule about 2.5 cm caudal to the vagina by a single duct. The Bartholin's glands secrete mucus actively at estrus and have a tubulo-alveolar structure. The bitch, ewe, mare, and sow have only minor vestibular glands. Vestibular glands are small in the bitch but numerous. Now, the major role of the vagina, it is the site of semen deposition in many species, whereas the major role of the cervix, it prevents the entry of the bacteria inside, and it opens at estrus and at parturition. then this picture it shows the Gartner's ducts. These are the two small Gartner's duct, and this is the external urethral orifice, and on both sides are located the Bartholin's gland. Then the vestibular bulbs, they are present in the mare and bitch. They are dark patches on the vestibular walls, and vestibular bulbs are a concentration of veins forming erectile tissue. This is the female homologue of the bulb of the penis. During the dog's tie, the bulbs are erect and press against the penis caudal to the enlarged bulb of the glans penis. Then the epithelium of the vagina, the anterior vagina and the fornix, the vagina has got the columnar epithelium, and in the vestibule it has got the stratified squamous epithelium. The then this is the vulvovaginal sphincter. Then the vagina of the mare, the posterior vagina, the inner surface, and the vulvovaginal sphincter. This is the vulvovaginal sphincter, and then the opening of the anterior vagina. And in another picture shown above, you can see the with clarity, you can see the anterior vagina, the urethra, the vulvovaginal sphincter, and the vestibule. Then the vagina of the sow is followed by the corkscrew type, the cervix of the sow. The vagina of the bitch, the vagina of the bitch is comparatively longer, and it's not horizontal, but it's vertically placed in some species. And again, in this picture also, you can appreciate that the cervix is perpendicular to the vagina, and this is the fornix. So these are some of the differences, anatomic differences. Then the hymen is a membranous structure, that is an embryonic remnant, sometimes present in the vestibule, and is represented by a few small transverse folds at the vaginovestibular junction. The hymen, it usually very rarely persistent, and in this one it's persistent, and one has to open it surgically. Otherwise, hymen is not very prominent in most domestic animal species. Then the external genitalia, the vulva, is formed by two labia that meet at the dorsal and ventral commissures surrounding the vertical vulvar opening. The dorsal commissure is rounded in the cow and sheep, whereas the ventral commissure is pointed. In the mare, the dorsal commissure is pointed and the ventral is rounded. So this is the difference in the commissures of the vagina in the ruminant species and the mare. The vulva provides the anatomical closure to the vagina so as to minimize entry of foreign material into the vagina. And so it's very important in the mare specifically, because with aging, and in some mares, the vulvar lips, they become loose, and then a commonly performed operation to correct at those at the stud is the Caslick operation or vulvoplasty. Then in this picture you can see the anus, and then the vestibule, the urogenital orifice, and the vulva. In these pictures you can see the external vulvar lips of cattle. This one you can see in cattle, indigenous cow, and then a HF cow, the external vulvar lips of a mare, that of a bitch, and that of a buffalo. Then the clitoris. The clitoris is the partial homologue of the penis. It's located within the ventral commissure and can be divided into two parts, the body, and has left and right crura attached to the ischiatic arch. The glans is the only exposed part of the clitoris. You can see here in this picture, the clitoris is prominent in the mare and it has got a fossa clitoridis, whereas a clitoris is very small in the cow. And this picture, it shows a prominent clitoris in a bitch. So friends, if you like my lecture, kindly give your likes, give your comments and suggestions, share the video, and subscribe to my YouTube channel if you like it. So thank you very much. Have a nice day. Press the bell button to subscribe to the channel. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.